bring the meeting to order. Will everyone please rise for the invocation and pledge of allegiance?
Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you tonight to conduct the business of this great county. We ask that you give us discernment and grant us wisdom as we consider each item brought before us tonight. We seek your will in all that we do. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Teresa, will you review the meeting procedures?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Welcome to the Forsyth County Planning Commission meeting. We would like to take just a few minutes to cover the procedures of this meeting for those of you that are not familiar with them. For all public hearings, the Planning Commission will allot 10 minutes per side, not 10 minutes per speaker. Please only request to speak if you have something new to add. Please refrain from disrupting this meeting through general outburst and applause. The public is reminded that addressing the Planning Commission or the Board of Commissioners directly is not allowed. All comments shall be directed to the application being heard by the boards. Anyone wishing to productively contribute is welcome to speak during the respective public hearing. Anyone speaking at the public hearing is required to complete a public hearing sign-in sheet, and those sheets are available as you enter the meeting room or from our staff. The Department of Planning and Development is open Monday through Friday from 8:30 until 5 o'clock. If you have any questions on any of the cases that are before you tonight, you're welcome to call us or email. The recommendations of this meeting will be heard on the Board of Commissioners meeting on September the 17th, 2009. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Motion to second. Any discussion? All in favor? Unanimous. Motion passes. Number 9, public hearing for rezonings. Mathis Crossing, ZA3463, has been postponed until December. Number 2, Atlanta Road, LLC, ZA3474. Teresa?
This is to rezone from R1 CBD to M2 with a conditional use permit for a construction and demolition C&D landfill with 5 parking spaces on 23.39 acres. Its location is on the southeast side of Georgia Highway 400, approximately 2,268 feet southwest from the intersection of North Old Atlanta Road and Georgia Highway 400, and on the northwest side of Ronald Reagan Boulevard, approximately 1,633 feet south of the intersection of North Old Atlanta Road and Ronald Reagan Boulevard. This property is located in Commission District Number 1. Staff is supportive of the rezoning and the conditional use permit.
Thank you, Teresa. Is there a motion to open the public hearing?
Move.
Second.
All in favor? Unanimous. Before we get started, I want to remind everyone, because it looks like there's a pretty good turnout for this one, that it's 10 minutes per side, so you need to keep your comments short, and ideally that you'd pick a few members of your group to speak to take up that 10 minutes. So. With that, who would like to speak in favor of the applicant, Atlanta Road, LLC?
Mr. Chairman, members of the Planning Commission, I'm Emory Lipscomb here on behalf of Atlanta Road, LLC. I would like to say, to begin with, that this afternoon around, 3:30 or so, it came to our attention that there was an issue with respect to the name Atlanta Road LLC, and the applicant being the applicant, and I checked with my client, and my client said, so far as he was aware, that name had been properly reserved by his attorney, not our firm, but another firm that had reserved that name, and we checked with the Secretary of State's office, and. They showed that that an attorney, I believe, in Smyrna, Georgia, had recently formed this limited liability company, and my client is not familiar with the name of that attorney or the formation in Smyrna. It shows it on the Secretary of State's records as having a principal office address, post office box in Roswell, Georgia. The application was signed by Michael K. Burke in our office. Mr. Burke worked for Clay Jarrell, who we have introduced at the public participation meetings as the principal, who would be the applicant and the operator owner of this business. But I don't want there to be any misunderstanding here, and if the chair or the planning commission or the planning department feels that this is a matter which should be corrected, that is, the name of the applicant ought to be Clay Jarrell, for instance, we'll be glad to amend the application, show it to be Clay Jarrell, who's here with me tonight, and move forward with that name. We'll either do that in the form of a postponement of this public hearing for a month to let this be advertised in Clay Jarrell's name, or we'll be glad to go forward with our presentation to you tonight and re-advertise it between now and the Board of Commissioners meeting, just so there wouldn't be a misunderstanding. I apologize. I didn't learn of this, like I say, until late this afternoon, and I don't know any better way to deal with it than just okay. Be straightforward.
Any thoughts, Tom?
I think we would say we don't see a reason to stop the public hearing. You've already got a good amount of people. It looks like they've turned out for it. We can check with the legal staff tomorrow, and if there was a some kind of problem, we could re-advertise it then. But when it comes right down to it, we don't have any real technical requirements for an applicant name. You could put just about anything, and our main purpose of having an applicant name is to be able to track the application in our and reference the application in our house in the office. So
if a person comes in under the name of an LLC, what type of check do we do to verify?
Absolutely nothing.
Okay. So it's just a name for the file, so to speak.
It's we name do on get the file. Yeah,
they have to prove ownership and title to put an application on that property, or those papers have to be together, right?
Sorry, we need title opinion on the property.
Right. Yeah.
So behind it could be the Middle Eastern Land Development Corporation, and we wouldn't know the difference.
That's right. There's no requirement for the applicant to be the owner. Mm-hmm. Right. We need to show the owner on the title opinion.
Right. Okay.
And names change too, so you can't really track that.
Okay.
We don't. It boils down to no. We don't have the staff doesn't have a concern with that.
Okay. So go forward, Emory.
All right. Again, I'm Emory Lipscomb. I'm here on behalf of this applicant, and this is a request for an M2 zoning with a conditional use permit for the operation of a C&D landfill on this property. It's located on the northwest side of Ronald Reagan Boulevard. The property is across the road there from Lafarge Aggregates, and it adjoins on the west side the northbound lane of Georgia Highway 400. This is 23.39 acres of land that's currently zoned R1 and CBD. Again, we're proposing an M2 zoning with a conditional use permit, heavy industrial for waste management facility. The proposed use, as I've said, is a C&D waste management facility. And the definition of a C&D is, as defined by the Georgia DNR EPD, is shown there. I won't read that. Folks can read it for themselves. But basically, it's for rubble resulting from construction, remodeling, repair, and demolition operations on pavements, houses, commercial buildings, and other structures. We're familiar with these sort of uses, and currently, to the best of our ability to determine it, there are only two C&D landfills operating in Forsyth County. One of these is on Georgia Highway 306, about 5 miles east of Georgia Highway 400 at 306, and the other one is at the Eagle Point landfill, which is located there on Old Federal Road near the Dawson County line. So it's probably 15 miles north of the subject property, northwest. The next is the site plan. This property is across the road from the Lafarge rock quarry there. You see Georgia State Highway 400 there on the north side of this site plan, and on the south side of it you see Ronald Reagan Boulevard. It's proposed to have an entryway that we'll talk more about a little later, and that would be shielded from view from Ronald Reagan by a planting of trees along Ronald Reagan, and there would also be a shielding from Georgia Highway 400. You can see that on this screen. The next is the site plan for the proposed entrance, and that shows the planning along the entire frontage there on Ronald Reagan with the office there and the scales for vehicles that will be entering the property. Next slide shows the Georgia 400 landscape rendering, and along Georgia 400 there will be of course, there's an existing right-of-way. The first thing you have there to the east of the road, there's additional right-of-way which belongs to the Georgia DOT, and of course that won't be disturbed. Then to the east of that, there is a landscape. There'll be a landscape buffer, and as the property is developed, there will be an additional landscape planting of evergreens which will grow to a height of 50 feet at their maturity to continue to shield the view of this from people's line of sight coming north on Georgia 400. This is shown on the next slide, which you have there. It's an enlargement of the other one, and it shows how that buffer setback and then the planning would work as it continues to go forward. The next slide is a map which shows the area that we're dealing with here, and you see it's color coded. And the purple color, which is this is taken from the county's future land use map, is indicated for use as industrial property. Then, just briefly, this next slide shows the county staff has issued a supportive recommendation with respect to this application. The next one is the GMRDC finding that the proposed development is in the best interest of the state, and that continues on the next slide, which has a comment from U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service saying, based on available information, federally listed species are not likely to occur on the project site. There's no water that's been found by Forsyth County to be located on this property. No streams located on this, this subject property, and that's part of the reason it's so well-suited for this use. The next slide is the Greta findings, and at that point, I'd be glad to answer any questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions right now?
Emory, you made a comment there about the streams. I thought it, there was a comment by staff that indicated that there were intermittent streams. I know I've walked the property, and there were adjacent property that had streams, and then you have two lakes that are in near proximity, I guess, Murchison's Lake, and then across 400 is another one. But I was curious about your comment there. Can you clarify that?
Yes, sir. I personally walked the property with Ethan Underwood and Simon Wilkes and Steve Dempsey, and then later that same day we met you down there because you were, you had expressed concern about a stream you had found, and you weren't sure whether it was on this property or not. And we walked to the location of that stream, and it was some 800 or 900 feet to the south of this property. And neither I nor the county indicated that there was able to see any streams of any nature on the subject property. And we walked to the area to begin with where the county representative said that they would expect there to be water if there was going to be any water there. So I'm not aware of any intermittent streams.
In the staff report, it says NRCS comments, and then it reads, there is an intermittent stream on land lot. And so that's what I was.
Yes, sir.
Was contradictory to what you had indicated. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else like to speak in favor of the applicant? Okay. Anyone like to speak in opposition? ZA 3474.
Good evening, gentlemen. My name is Jack Gleason. Concerned citizen of Forsyth County, residing at 1595 Robbins Walk, and I speak this evening on behalf of Smart Growth Forsyth County. Smart Growth is opposed to zoning application 3474 for the following reasons. The proposed landfill lies within the Big Creek Small Water Supply Watershed Overlay, which is an environmentally sensitive natural resource of significant value to our area, requiring preventative protection measures. It is within the overlay. It also lies within or upon a minor aquifer recharge zone or groundwater recharge area, which has been geologically verified and mapped by the Georgia Department of Natural Resources groundwater table and noted within the Forsyth County Comprehensive Plan. If the aquifer becomes polluted, and I quote, it is virtually impossible to decontaminate it. Three, it is adjacent to an area identified as having high pollution susceptibility, as well as within an area identified as having a severely restricted hazardous materials handling area. And I don't have there's a map that depicts that, a variety of degrees of severeness throughout the county, and that is an area and adjacent to the city of Cumming city limits, which is depicted as a high pollution susceptibility area. The landfill rests, or the proposed landfill, rests on what has already been identified as a geologically unstable area, perhaps unstable enough to threaten the integrity of any contaminant means used within the landfill. And finally, this landfill is proposed immediately adjacent to the quarry that is the most likely viable site of what should become Forsyth County's own future water supply reservoir. On behalf of Smart Growth Forsyth County and its citizensry that it represents, I pray that you find the merit in these considerations this evening and recommend denial to the Forsyth County Board of Commissioners of zoning application 3474. Any questions?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, commissioners. I am a...
Hold on. Speak your name first.
My name is Gray Smith, and I don't live anywhere remotely close to this proposed landfill, though I have some experience in C&D and inert landfills, as I was opposed to one some years ago up in my area, which is the northeast part of the county. The gentleman that spoke just before me was correct. There is an underground recharge area. You don't have to have water running on the surface of the ground in order to have a significant amount underground. And as he mentioned, the Lafarge area is a great area for water. When I was a little boy, some of y'all are probably old enough to remember this, we played a game a lot of times on birthdays called Ooey Gooey. You'd have about half a dozen bags, and in five of the bags, you'd have nice games and prizes and treats and candy. In one of them, you'd have Ooey Gooey. I submit to you that in my experience in using these landfills, 38 years in the tree business, commercial and residential in the Atlanta area, probably about 10% of your truckloads are going to be Ooey Gooey truckloads. And I've got a little illustration.
Mr. Smith, I'm not going to allow you to open that bag. You can tell me what's in it and make your points, but
Chairman, can we allow? I mean, he's
no.
He checked with the sheriff's department, had made a phone call, and
I don't think it's required.
I had spoken with you earlier. I think it's. I mean, it's safe.
Let's let the citizen taxpayers be heard,
Mr. Chairman.
Okay, that's enough. Seriously, Mr. Smith, your time is up. Your time is up. No. There's no semblance of control, Brent. I'm going to stop you from dumping trash on the floor of this meeting room.
This is not a circus. This is what's going to go into the landfill.
I understand. You can speak those things to me. I do not have to see them.
It was relayed to me by our county attorney where he was at in a county that he serves also, where somebody brought in what was essentially a container full of the waste product that comes out, some of the leachate, and they allowed them to open it up. They actually had to clear the room for that, but it was tolerated and allowed. I've been down to the Secretary of State's office and seen a lot of tolerance.
To tell you what's in the bag.
Seen people sing.
I will let you tell me what's in the bag.
Okay, Mr. Russell, in that bag is insecticide cans, motor oil cans, along with the new high-tech light bulbs that are full of mercury. People with the best of intentions, when they're taking something to a landfill and they have leaves and sticks and whatnot, they might take a light bulb and put it in there, not knowing. It's full of mercury. There's also a small battery in there for a riding lawnmower. Mr. Russell, I've been in the business that uses these landfills for 38 years. That's probably about as long as you've been on this earth. And I'll tell you, sir, it's not a pretty sight. There's a lot of responsible people that use these landfills, but there's a lot that aren't. And when I go to a landfill or I send my men to landfills, 99% of the time, there is a little mobile home, little trailer sitting there next to the scales, and it's air conditioning, and somebody's bored in there watching a General Hospital or something, and they slide a little door open, and they say, "What you got in there?" And you say, "I got tree trash." They say, "Go on with it." My argument is that all the stuff that's in this bag that I'm going to dispose of properly, and by the way, I paid for those French fries and didn't even eat them one. I brought them for your purpose. And I didn't even get a strawberry milkshake today. But my point is this is right in an area we want to have medical facilities. It's right next to the hospital. It's next to Lafarge where the drinking water is going to hopefully come from one day. It's high density. This is not a circus. This is reality right here. This is what happens. And I would submit to y'all that anybody that proposes to put something in this is no different from the movie Dumb and Dumber. It does not make sense. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
My name is Nydia Tisdale. I live at 1240 Oak Haven Drive in Roswell, Georgia. I am the property manager for 80 acres of land on Georgia Highway 400, Highway 9, and Ronald Reagan Boulevard. I have sent numerous emails to all of you and several letters, and the letter actually has grown into, in fact, a book with all of my attachments and articles and supporting documents. So Mr. Bill Talbot will hand out my book to each of you, as well as a petition signed by how many names on the petition? About 400 names.
Okay.
In the zoning application, ZA3474, I'll read this from you. It's on page 6 of 6, item 10. Forsyth County will not process any application for an applicant in which past due taxes are due. So this application includes the following sworn statement. I hereby swear under oath that there are no past due taxes due and owing on real property, which is the subject of this application. I further swear that I, being the applicant, have no other property taxes due for any other property in Forsyth County. Please list all properties owned by the applicant by indicating the tax map and parcel PIN number, information, or property address if known. Be aware that you will need to provide evidence of paid taxes by either attaching a paid tax bill or an affidavit from the tax commissioner's office. On the list of properties owned, it lists none. If you'll please turn the page in my book, I have listed a property tax digest for Mr. Clay Jarrell of all of his property in Forsyth County, which was omitted from this application 3474. And in this list, I include the ad valorem tax bills from 2008 that remain unpaid. And it's my understanding of your rules of uniform development code, if I'm saying that properly, that you will not hear an application from an applicant who owes the county taxes.
We can discuss that later, but if you want to keep going with your points.
A limited liability company cannot open a bank account without articles of organization. One cannot open a bank account without a driver's license. You have to prove who you are. You have to prove your identity. It's know your customer. Know who you're dealing with. Who is the party? Who is the applicant? Atlanta Road LLC, they reserved a name 2 years ago, and the name expired. They weren't competent enough to file articles of organization with the Secretary of State, and their name reservation expired. If an applicant fails to do that simplest of a task for creating a limited liability company, how could the county expect and trust that applicant to be in charge of its waste facility and a landfill, which there's a tremendous amount of paperwork required and record keeping required to own and operate a landfill? My business partner, Ron Slack, has been in the landfill business. He has owned and operated Safeguard Landfill Management, Inc. on Roosevelt Highway in South Fulton County in the early 1990s, which he has sold, and he also subsequently applied for a permit in Douglas County on 145 acres of land, and he tried to get a permit for that property for 10 years, and he was ultimately turned down by Douglas County. This isn't a case of NIMBY. It's not in my backyard. My partner is a landfill applicant himself, and he knows the economics of what a good location for a landfill would be. With this 23-acre site, you can only put a 7-acre footprint. Mike Burke asked my partner, Ron Slack, if he would trade some of his acreage, which adjoins this property, in exchange for some grading services, because by his own admission, this property really is too small for a landfill. It just isn't economically viable. You don't have the economies of scale that you need for a landfill to make it worthwhile. Yes, he has some grading equipment because he's in the grading business, but, and I really regretfully have to share this with you, it's going to be sold on the courthouse steps on September 1st for a tax deed sale. And it's very tough for everyone in these economic times, and I'm not saying that mean-spiritedly, but we should know who this applicant is. And he has failed to disclose that on the application. And I think there is a very serious problem with that. You need to know who you're dealing with. And you need to know if they're financially qualified to run a landfill. You have to post a bond. It's a very highly liable business. It's not one to be taken lightly. There's a lot of legal responsibility, a lot of financial responsibility with operating a landfill. It's not just an ice cream store. The state passed laws in the early 90s with they're called the CERCLA laws, the Superfund laws, where if there is pollution to the environment, to the sea, to the waters, to the land, to the air, there's triple damages for cleaning any messes up. And there's punitive damages. The state won't tolerate it. The Georgia EPD, they're very strict in regulating the waste from its inception until its burial. And your liability for polluting goes from the cradle to the grave. There's no statute of limitations for polluting our earth. It's forever. The liability is forever. It's forever on the land. It's forever on the individual. If this land were a landfill and it were closed and it were given to the county for a park, you would inherit that risk and that liability, that legal responsibility. I wouldn't want it in the Parks Department. In one of my articles, there's a youth who was crossing through a park, and he saw some smoke coming out of the ground, and he investigated and fell in a hole and got third-degree burns, and it was a former C&D landfill that was turned into a recreational park. There are tremendous fire hazards. They're not appropriate for a park. And I know my time is running out. I'll make a very quick point. We also had a property in Gwinnett County that had a tree mulching facility on it. It accepted stumps, and it was piled high. It caught fire, and it burned from Halloween in 1996 until Valentine's Day in 1997. It burned for 4 months before it could be extinguished. And it wasn't even a landfill. It was just a tree mulching facility, which is what Mr. Gerald intends to do, is to accept stumps and grind them up, accept concrete and perhaps grind it up for 57 gravel, and then bury some of the other things. I have so much more to say, and that's why I've written all of you this book. I hope that you will read it. This is a very serious request for a landfill. Please don't take it lightly. Thank you for listening to me.
Thank you. Sir, before you begin, they're out of time. Does anybody want to make a motion to extend it?
I would motion to extend the time for each side by 5 minutes.
Motion and a second. Please vote. 4-1. All opposed? Okay. 4-1. You have 5 minutes, sir.
Thank you very much. My name is Dr. Batra. I live in Bethelview subdivision in Cumming, Georgia. My opposition to this rezoning is based on technical grounds. I have 40 years experience in environmental health, and I am saying not in my backyard because it's literally in my backyard. I'm the property next door. It's a little bit disingenuous of Mr. Lipscomb, whom I otherwise respect very much, to present those two certificates, one of which said they have no statement, they have no comment to make on this, and he's taking that as a recommendation, which is rather ridiculous. And the other is that they didn't find any species which was which is indigenous to this area. And so that cannot be again used as a recommendation just because they didn't find an indigenous species. Second point that I have to make about preliminary meeting about this sort of thing is again very disingenuous, because supposedly it is to inform the public that this meeting took place, which most of us, we attended there, and there was a almost unanimous disapproval of that application. There were so many ideas presented at that meeting, and based on which Mr. Lipscomb comes forth with a very cosmetic plan of action, where he says people will not be able to see because there will be 50-foot trees growing at a certain point in time. That was not the idea that was put forth at that time, but that this entire plan lacks a technical plan which does not address, number one, leaching of chemicals, hazardous waste, that the individual has no control over when the when the dumping is taking place into the landfill. Two, EPD is cited, but they base their recommendations based on your zoning. And so I think this is the ground zero, so to speak, that you need to present to us the entire proposal, the technical proposal. Now, you were objecting to this gentleman's demonstration. Perhaps you were right, but please keep in mind there was a point to his presentation, and that was that there's no control what kind of chemicals are going to be coming into this. There is no control going in, and there's no control monitoring of those leachates of chemicals into properties next door, particularly Georgia 400, which may be the view may be protected, but the chemicals don't. The chemical leaches know no bounds, particularly if it's an aquifer lying underneath, which will contaminate the water of the entire county. And based on these grounds, I submit to you that this should be denied.
Thank you. You have 1 minute.
1 minute.
Yep. Well, state your name.
My name is Bill Talbot. I'm with the Woodland Park Subdivision in South Forsyth. I'm here to go again to oppose this because I'm looking from a public safety concern. Look at additional trucks, traffic. Look at the additional just damage in the area that's going to create with the additional leach fields, et cetera. I totally agree with what everyone else has been speaking to. That residual seepage is just it's unimaginable what it's going to do to a potential water supply right next door. I personally don't see a need for an additional C&D landfill. We've been doing great for 15 years without an additional location down at this down in South Forsyth. We have an additional C&D landfill literally 5 miles away from this property. And from that perspective, it's been communicated that having something within 5 miles literally less than an hour is absolutely awesome from that perspective. So that was, so from a Woodland Park subdivision, you actually saw the petitions with about 400 signatures on it. Those are definitely neighbors and friends within the South community that definitely oppose this.
And so, where is the neighborhood?
South Forsyth, Brandon and Old Atlanta.
Brandon and Old Atlanta?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Is there a motion to close the public hearing? You have a motion? Oh, we're going to give Emory. I'm sorry. Yep, that's right. Thank you for the point of order there. I'll withdraw it.
I'm not going to try to address all of this, and I know that's a blessing to everyone here. But first of all, as far as the materials which will be allowed there, the materials which were mentioned by Grace Smith are not permitted, and the EPD rules require that the disposal site shall be under the supervision of an operator who is present at all times during the operation and who is properly trained in the operation of landfills. The operator must have successfully completed the landfill certification training course and examination endorsed by the EPD. Now, we all know that we can violate the law. We can go out here and drive on the wrong side of the road, or we can do a lot of things and violate the law. But if we do that, we're subject to punishment under those laws that we're violating. And that's the same for a landfill as it is anything else. If you just decide I don't like to pay income taxes and I'm never going to pay income taxes, you may never be caught at it, but you may be caught. If Gray knows of people who have been violating the laws for 38 years, he ought to go to the EPD and tell them who's doing that. I don't think it's a good thing to come here and say I've been in this business for 38 years and I know that this is violated every day of the year. If he knows that, he ought to go and protect the environment by telling the EPD about that. So I think that's something that we've got to have more confidence in our government. And that we've got to have more confidence in people than to say that we know that these oil is going to be dumped in the site here and these other things. Second of all, my client has agreed that they would put in, if required by the EPD, a clay liner and a synthetic liner, both. On this, they're not required for a C&D landfill to put in either one of these. But if the EPD deems because of an underground aquifer, or because Forsyth County shows serious interest in putting a reservoir across the road, shows that land is available for that purpose, shows that the county has allocated the money to purchase that land and plans to do so, then the EPD can say we think that there's a need here to put additional protections against that water being polluted, and that could take the form of one or both of those types of protection, that is a clay liner and a synthetic liner, and my client's willing to do that. You're going to need these type facilities because this county is going to continue to grow. It's a long ways from this part of the county and south of here to the landfills that are located to the north. Those will fill up, particularly the one there on 306. The one on Old Federal will be there for a long time. It has a long lifespan. But this is just like the rock quarry and garbage collection. It's something where you've got people you're going to have the need to do this kind of work. Thank you very much.
Emory, did you want to respond to the taxes? Do you have any information on that?
I'm sorry?
Did you want to respond to the tax question, payment of taxes by the applicant? Do you have any information on that?
At the time this application was filed, there were no, I'm told by my client, that there were no past due taxes. That was the application.
Are there past due taxes now?
Yes, they are. In Clay Gerald's name, they are.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any further questions before we close the public hearing?
I've got a question.
For who? Okay. Do you know her name?
Ms. Tisdale.
Could you step forward, please?
Certainly, yes. I had a couple of questions. Your partner has property adjoining this, correct?
Yes, sir. 55 acres on Georgia Highway 400 and Ronald Reagan Boulevard.
And that was offered for sale to Mr. Gerald, correct?
Actually, Mike Burke contacted us, and we saw him after one of the meetings in March, and he asked, would you be willing to sell us some of your property or trade some of your property to add to our acreage to increase the footprint of the landfill? And they had a lively discussion about landfills and their experience, and Ron offered that if you found a better location, I might even joint venture it with you, but it's not going to work here. You've got a 100-foot elevation slope from the 400 up to Ronald Reagan. It's too steep. It's too small. It's too tiny with all the setbacks. It's just not economically viable. As he said, the dog won't hunt. It's not worth it.
But he did, your partner did offer to sell him the entire
property. We did not offer to sell him anything. We did not offer. He asked us if we would consider giving him some of our land so that he could have an economically viable landfill, because a tiny 22 or 23-acre landfill is not economically viable.
What about the, you know, all the emails that I saw from you cited Lake Lafarge. To me, that's a misrepresentation. This county has no plans to buy that quarry right now. Yes, maybe one day. The quarry has another 25 years lifespan. Maybe one day. Maybe one day pigs will fly. But to me, that was a misrepresentation to get all these people out here. And you're talking about his integrity, these things, you know, the fact that your property, and I could, maybe I was told wrong, that it was for sale. The whole entire 50 plus acres was for sale, but they couldn't come together on a price. Now, maybe I'm wrong on that. I don't know.
We're waiting for the medical community to grow and develop. Children's, as you know, health care has purchased property on Ronald Reagan and Georgia 400, and eventually, in time, as you say, like Lake Lafarge, possibility in 25 years. It could be 25 years, and we'll hold the property if it takes that long for a medical corridor campus, which is, I think, the best use for that property, not a landfill.
Didn't, at one time, didn't your partner have a lawsuit with somebody about a crack that runs through his property?
It's not, we do, and it has not been settled yet.
But that being said, would that be a good place for a medical facility with a crack running through the property?
It could be graded out. Okay. You build tall buildings in San Francisco, and that's on a quake fault.
Well,
people live in San Francisco.
The people in San Francisco aren't suing California for it either.
I apologize. I didn't hear your comment. I'm sorry.
The people in San Francisco aren't suing California either.
Aren't
suing California.
Very well.
Not for being on a quagmire fault. Okay. They're not, because their property has a crack,
okay,
they're not suing the state.
Excuse me. I want to get.
What about the, you stated that this was not, and you talk about the traffic and the, how many more trucks and so on and so forth. How many more could you have when you've got a quarry across the street? And keep in mind, I'm not for or against it right this second. I'm probably leaning against it. But I don't like the misrepresentation and not having all the information given to all the people.
May I read from the minutes of Tuesday, January 27th, 2009, which is in your book, the Board of Commissioners meeting, work session, items for consideration and discussion, number 6, discussion of plans for future use of Ronald Reagan Boulevard Quarry, Chairman Laughinghouse. Chairman Laughinghouse introduced George Wolper to the board. Mr. Wolper is part of the family interest that owns the land where the Lafarge Quarry is located. Chairman Laughinghouse and Mr. Wolper have had discussions in the past regarding the use of the property when the quarry ceases to be active. Chairman Laughinghouse stated that the Ronald Reagan Boulevard Quarry could possibly be used for a reservoir storage facility.
Yes,
this was for informational purposes only. No action was taken.
Right.
And that's where I got the information from your board minutes in January about the potential use of the quarry when it ceases to be a quarry as a water reservoir. And no, I wasn't trying to be alarmist. But it is true, to the best of my knowledge, that a water reservoir for drinking supply cannot be located near a C&D construction and demolition debris landfill.
I just, like I said, I just wanted to point out that you did own property next to it. I was under the impression that it was your property. It was discussed selling your property to this landfill, and that they did not didn't want to pay the price. And referring to Lake Lafarge, and these Lake Lafarge emails started coming before that, I believe. Now, I'm not sure. But anyway, the fact is that the quarry's there for another 25 years. The expectancy of the landfill is 4 to 8 years. And then they maintain it for another 30 and then give it to the county. So I just, you know, I didn't feel like all the facts were there. I mean, as I said, at this right this second, I'm in the air about it. But I just didn't feel like, you know, I felt like once we were getting one side of the story from all of your emails. And that's generally the way it is. Unfortunately, all the facts aren't in everybody's things.
And that's why I tried very hard for the past year to gather as many facts as I could possibly find about landfills, about landfill fires, about the medical development in this corridor, about the shopping center development in this corridor, about the educational facility development in this corridor, and everything that would be counterintuitive to having a landfill in this corridor. So if you'll take the time to read my book, I think, I hope I have made a convincing point.
It is an industrial area, though. I mean, you agree. I mean, you want to put a nursing home next to a rock quarry.
There's several already that are zoned for that very purpose there.
Right across the street.
Right across the street.
Really?
I mean, oh, yeah.
Well, don't. I hope my kids don't put me there.
But as, but as far as Mr.
Partner has been in the real estate business for 50 years, and he's been involved in probably at least 500 transactions all over the state of Georgia, and he's very savvy on the uses of land and the direction of growth, and he's been holding this for quite a long time, and he has been a landfill owner and operator, and he's been very successful in his multitude of businesses, and I defer to his judgment that this just is not a good place for a landfill.
But it's
he has
not
experience.
His land.
No, it's not his land.
Okay.
And
that's
actually
it.
If he had thought that this would be a good location for a landfill, he would have applied himself for his 55 acres of land adjoining this tiny 23 acres of land.
Okay. No problem. I just, like I said, I just thought there was a little misleading there going on.
I certainly did not intend to mislead anyone. I apologize if I did so.
Thank you, ma'am.
Any other?
Good. To her? Okay.
May,
you can have a seat, ma'am. Thanks.
May I, I forgot to do this last time. May I do one more thing?
We're really out of time. I think we're good. Thanks. Let's close the public hearing and then have discussion. Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Mr. Quinn?
Lafarge is an obvious possibility for a water supply, drinking water supply reservoir. They have potential of quarrying it for the next 25 years. But if the county found itself in a dire situation, they could go in and condemn that property anytime. That could be done next month, next year, 3 years from now, if we find out we don't have a water supply. Lafarge could become an emergency.
Speaking to the mic there.
At which time we have to build a dam, which we don't have the money for.
This is an issue, in my opinion, that... This is an issue, in my opinion, that's not a matter of money. If we have to, we'll find the money to get us some drinking water.
Okay. Any other discussion? Is that on or off?
It's on. I have a statement I was going to make.
Okay. Any other questions for anyone? Or I think Brent's ready to move forward. Okay. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Throughout the country, the public has begun to show a lack of confidence in the government, as evidenced by some of the town hall meetings relative to health care. If we're looking for the federal government to protect us, I think we may be woefully short in that protection. I think it all starts locally, and I think the reality of it is that locally it has to be controlled. I have some concerns about the failures to pay taxes. Also concerns that if we do accept something of the proposal that was taught, there's a considerable amount of risk and responsibility. The EPD sets forth that the applicant would be doing their own self-monitoring. In the preface of the UDC, it reads in paragraph B, manage growth so as to not overburden the county infrastructure nor significantly detract from quality of life. In addition, in the preface, it goes on to read, protect and conserve the beauty and integrity of the county's natural features and historic resources. Those may just be words, but they are words that somebody thought enough to actually put them on paper. There are also issues that I have with... in Chapter 8, and particularly Section 3, Part B2C, regarding considerations for decision, whether or not the applicant's proposal will have an adverse effect on the usability of adjacent or nearby property. I feel that it does. It also brings up the concerns about pollution or of surface or subsurface water. I believe that's a concern. I believe noise and odor and visual intrusions, which are also listed in the UDC in Chapter 8, also are viable concerns. Oftentimes there's a discussion about if this is the use that was anticipated or are they being denied. The applicant at one time, or at least the owners, thought that it was viable for high-rise office, medical, and hotel. And so I would submit that there are other uses that are available for the property other than a land. And with that, I would make a motion to recommend to the Forsyth County Board of Commissioners denial of the application for Atlanta Road LLC, ZA3474.
I have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor of the motion for denial? Y'all good? You couldn't hear it? Okay. Was it four to, was it unanimous or unanimous? Okay. Okay. ZA3520 Ricky Bryan from Res 2 to A1. Teresa? Now they're good.
Should we let them?
Okay. Go. Give them a minute.
But we're so close to. No, it didn't catch me off guard.
Just take a 5-minute recess.